Now listen, you don't need to have my size to serve God. Serve God faithfully in what He has entrusted you to. If you are a cleaner, don't feel like you are less. You will be rewarded not for what you do, but by doing it faithfully. God does not reward work. He rewards faithfulness. Now listen, the reason why God does not reward work is because I can force you to work.
And so, Lord, I speak a blessing to my viewers today. I pray that the spirit of understanding will be our portion. I pray that the illumination of your word will enhance our walk. I pray that the truth will find room and become a pillar of our conviction. I pray for everyone that is watching right now, those who will be watching, catching up along the way. We pray for the spirit of understanding, and we pray for the unction of the Spirit of God to touch them wherever they are. In Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen. Well, my viewers, we've been building Hope Alive, and we focus mainly on encouraging each other and motivating and assuring us and praying that something good is happening and giving us the assurance of what God is doing. This week, I want to talk to you about what I call living a strategic life. Living a strategic life. The principle behind this is to establish what I call progress. There is need for you to measure your progress in life. There is need for you to know where you began, where you are, where you're going to, how much distance have been covered, where are you, and how much remains. It's important for you to know what momentum you need to build, what skills you need to bring on board. Do you still to refresh, to renew? What are the challenges? So I'm terming it as living a strategic life. Three things that becomes paramount in discussing this topic, and I want you to come with me and follow through. Three things that are important for you to understand this topic and walk with us on this journey. Number one is to understand that your life is a pilgrimage. Your life is a journey. Your life is a journey. Whether you know it or not, you are on a journey. Whether you are conscious about it or not, you are on a journey. You began somewhere, you are going somewhere. And your age can tell it all. Your changes can tell it all. The demands of life can tell it all. David puts it like this. He says, I was young, now I'm old. You remember, men of old dream into the future, but they got to a place where they realize they have run their race. Paul puts it like this, I have run my race. I have pursued my course. There is a crown waiting for me. So number one, you need to know that your life is a pilgrimage. You are on a journey. You are running. You are considered as an athlete. The Bible calls you three things. The Bible calls you an athlete. The Bible calls you a soldier. And the Bible calls you a farmer. Your life rotates around something. You are on a journey. Life is a journey. It's a pilgrimage. So that's number one. Number two, you need to know that life is packaged in intervals called seasons. Between day one and the climax of life, within the pilgrimage, you have seasons in life. You need to understand whether it's winter, whether it's summer, whichever season you are in, so that you know how to behave right, how to prepare right. So life, as much as it's a pilgrimage, it's a journey, want you to know that life is packaged in seasons. Number three, I want you to know that God has packaged the will, the power to either pursue the dream of your life or the journey ahead of you in the heart of a man, whether to pursue it or not. The power, the will, to pursue your dreams, to walk the journey, to go through the season is in you. In simple words, it is within your power to walk that journey. It is within your power to pursue those dreams. Within your power to choose how to manage seasons. And that's what I want to dwell on living a strategic life. I want to address that part of the discussion on the willpower of a man to pursue that which is initiated or intended by God for a man. Now, I want you to know something. I repeat myself. God gave man the will, the power to choose either to pursue, to walk that journey, that purpose that is designed for him or not. God gave man the willpower. God gave man the willpower. And he gave the man the willpower in three platforms. Number one, he gave you the willpower through your desires. He gave you the willpower through your desires. So the willpower, remember, we are talking about living a strategic life. So God gave you the power to will, the power to pursue. It is within your power. So the first platform on your will, on the power of your will, is the power of desire. So you pursue things based on your desire. That is an indication that God does not force things down your throat. God does not capture you and throw you into a position against your wish. So God gave you something called desire. Number two, God gave you the power, what we call the power of decision. So you have on the will, you have desire, and then you have decision. You have the power and you have decision. And then number three, you have something called resolution. Resolution and decision may almost look like the same, but resolution is a settlement in your heart about what you want to pursue. Decision is a step towards it. So within your willpower, you have desire, you have decision, and you have resolution. Resolution is to make a conclusive move in your spirit based on conviction, based on your faith, and based on the understanding of what you want to pursue. Decision is the real act, the motion, the progress. And then, of course, God gave you the power to decide. That is why God always, listen to this. God always puts things within the distance of your sight, the distance of your appetite, and the distance of your strength. Let me give you an example so that you understand. When God wants to do something, he will only drop it within the distance of your desire. He will give you the desire for it. He will not bring it against your desire. He will give you the desire for it, but he will make sure the distance between what he wants to do and you is within the length of your desire. That's why when God wants to do something, he must quicken your desire for it. He must quicken your desire for it. Number two, that's why God gives something called vision. You must see it. You must be able to see. God will never give you until you see. Now remember, sight is a principle of your will. Sight is a principle of your will. You see what you want to see. You don't see because it is visible. You can have things in front of you. If you tell your will, I will not see it. You can be looking at it, but not see it. So God gave you what we call the ability to see. We call it vision. And that's why God always calls people. You realize God does not arrest people. God calls people. Why? He respects your will. Living a strategic life, therefore, talks about your ability to marry, your vision with the rest of the desires that are within you. It is in your ability to marry your will to your resolutions and your decisions. God always works with the will of the man. He will propose, he will prompt, he will prophesy, he will send us a dream, he will send us a word, but he will wait for your response. Throughout the Bible, when you look at the scriptures, you realize God walked with men based on their will, their resolution. God walked with men based on their will, their response. That's why you hear God had said to Abraham. Let's begin with Abraham. God had said to Abraham. God had said to Abraham. If you look at Genesis 12, you realize God spoke to Abraham way beyond the time of response. Theologian says Abraham had God sometimes back 12 years before he responded. He had God. That's why the Bible says, now in Haran. I even like what the Amplified Bible says. It says, now while he was still in Haran. That means he had not even left the location where he was. There is a place where God spoke to Abraham. He stayed longer in that location and then moved to another location and then moved to another location. If you read on the scriptures, you realize God spoke to Abraham when his father was still alive. But Abraham did not respond until his father died. That's very interesting. Look at it this way. Jesus said that a man went out to call men into his fold or into his assignment. And he went to one of them and said, you know what? Come and follow me. I am appealing to your will. I know the power, the resolution, the decision has to be made within you. You have the power. You remember the Bible says, life and death is in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat from it. So the Bible says, Jesus gave a parable, and he said, a man went out and called three categories of men, which all of us fall in that category, either or one of those categories. One of them was told, follow me. Now, remember, it was within his will, within his resolution and decision. The Bible says, the man said to the master or whoever called him, he said, listen, friend, my father just died. And my decision based on my will is that I'm going to bury my father. I am not following you. My decision within, and I have the will, I have the power to choose. Now, remember, Jesus is talking about a principle of the kingdom where someone is called into the vineyard or the assignment of the kingdom. And he purposely said, I will and I have the power. And within my will and power, I choose to follow my appetite. I resolve to pursue my sight. I choose to respond to the need. My father is dead. I'm going to bury him. And what does the Bible says? He was disqualified. One, the next said, I just got married. I have the will. He would have said, okay, I'll follow you. But I just got married. And the Bible talks about he was disqualified. A third one was told, follow me. Now, remember this. It is a proposal. It is not a coercion. It is not a threat. It is not forceful. Follow me. It's a request. I respect your will. I respect your resolution. I respect your power to choose. And the Bible says, he said, I just bought some oxen, and so I need to go test check on them before I follow you. Now, let's go to the disciples. If you look at Jesus, before we go back to Abraham, When the disciples were called, you realize there was no conversation. When Jesus said, follow me, the Bible says they left what they were doing and followed Jesus. It was within their will, but remember, it was a proposal. Follow me. Now, there was no negotiation. There was no discussion. They submitted and subjected their will to the call. They subjected their will to the call. Now listen, this is important. It's very hard for you to divide your will between two things. It's so hard for you to follow two things at the same time. The Bible says, a double-minded man, a man who has two destinations, a person who follows two things, he's called unstable. He is a man who is not worth to follow. You remember Jesus saying to the disciples, if you love father, mother, wife, children more than me, you are not worth this cause. That's why Peter would ask later, we've left all to follow you. What shall we get? The willpower of a man is always singular in resolution. The will of a man is always singular in a resolution. And I'm coming to you. Listen, successful men have married and tamed and packaged their will into one cause. This is important. Any successful man, and I'm coming to talk about that in the issue of ministry, family, business, leadership, and every aspect of life. Any successful man has brought together his vision, his desire, his resolution, his decision into one lens. Term them on one course. Jesus said this word. Listen to these words. You cannot serve two masters. You cannot divide yourself. You cannot serve two masters. You cannot divide your will. You cannot divide your power. You are either this or that. The Bible talks about you can't be warm and be cold. You can't be hot and cold. You have to be one. God refused to work with lukewarmness. Anybody who walked and met a meaningful or live a meaningful life met a conclusive decision. Now listen, friends, this is important to you. Until your will is in your decisions and your vision is in your will, your life will always go against the wishes and the purpose of God for your life. Remember, you are on a pilgrimage. You are on a pilgrimage. Let me give you an example so that you understand. Do you realize the children of Israel walked towards the promised land as far as their will would cooperate? The children of Israel walked that far. They walked the distance of their will. They walked the distance of their decision. They walked the distance of their appetite. They walked the distance of their desire. They walked the distance of their cooperation. When they lost the will to go to the promised land, the journey ended. When they swapped their will from the promised land to the land of bondage, that is where they came from, the journey ended. Now, I need to say this to somebody, and I'm coming to explain it further. It's very dangerous when your will begin to reflect on your past against your future. Now, let me say this. One of the undoings of life is when your past influences your present against your future. You're asking, how does that, what do you mean by that? This is what I mean. When you can justify your incompetence based on your past misfortunes, then you have allowed your past to influence your present against your future. In simple words, when you justify your present condition of incompetence, struggle, failure, misfortune, and relate them to your past, you will always have a reason to settle where you are, because what you justify takes permanent residence. I need to repeat that. What you justify takes permanent residence. If you say I am poor because of my past, then you justify poverty. You give poverty permanent residence, dwelling. You tell poverty you are legitimate. You have no reason to worry. I can't even send you away. I would grow you, because it's not your mistake, poverty. It is my past. So I won't blame you. I justify you by blaming my past. Success is a function of your will. This is important. Success is a function of your will. Listen, friends, success is a function of your will. Failure is a function of your will. A will, or the will of a man, must be married to his decisions, his resolution, his desires and appetite and vision, such that you think one thing, you walk one direction, you speak one language, you have one focus. Until you are single, until you are one, until everything about you is about you, everything about you is for you, everything about you is towards you, you will always struggle. Remember, it is possible to go around the mountain of life for the rest of your life. It's possible to go around the mountain and seem to be having an activity, but in reality, you are just creating motion, but no progress. It's possible to dwell and die in the wilderness. It is. And remember, the Bible says, everything that is written were written for our learning. Everything. So listen, you can never make progress beyond your willpower. You can never make progress beyond your willpower. The children of Israel, when they saw the working of God, remember right from Genesis, Exodus, from Egypt, God walked with their will. I want you to think about this. God will always propose his ideas to your will for purpose of partnership and for purpose of implementation. God will always propose his ideas to your will for purpose of partnership and for purpose of implementation. Okay, somebody's asking, let the will of God be done. That's exactly what he's looking for. You have to say, I let. The Lord's prayer is, let your kingdom come. I will, I surrender, I usher in, I receive you. Let your will be done. You must willingly respond to his proposal. When you pray, you must invite him. You must sign up. You must tell him, let your will be done. I submit to your will. Let your kingdom come. You must allow. Remember this as we come to a conclusion. God will always propose his ideas for your life, to your will, for purpose of cooperation and for purpose of implementation. God cannot implement anything in your life against or away from your will. It's important for you to know that. God cannot implement any thought, idea he has for your life against or minus or without the participation of your will. Your will must be a partner and must be the one doing the implementation. That's why the Bible says, I know the thoughts I have for you. I know the plans I have for you. They remain thoughts, they remain plans until you willingly embrace them and receive them. That's why whenever God wanted to heal somebody, he would ask about their will. We call it faith in the language of the Spirit. Faith is your will cooperating with the will of God. Listen, the will of God is supreme, but it does not dictate. The will of God is supreme in the sense that it guarantees success. If you cooperate with it, if you work with it, you are guaranteed of results. What it says, it will achieve. What God desires will come to pass. His word will not return to him void. If you follow and cooperate with it, you will succeed. But remember, he does not dictate. That answers the question then of our differences. Why is it that some people seem to be making progress and some people seem not to be making progress? We will answer those questions this week, and we will try to tame your will and align your willpower and your resolutions and your decision to one thing. Can I tell you something, ladies and gentlemen? Nobody is known in this life for living long. Anybody that is known in this life is somebody who chose to live for something. Life is not measured by length. It's measured by the impact you make by what you choose to live. Now, listen to this as we bring it to a close. People live through something. You don't just exist. Actually, the word life is when your desires, your wishes has found a platform of expression. That's living. The rest is called existing. The rest is called existing. Life is lived through something. It is called in the language of the Bible, purpose. Life is noticed, is lived, becomes relevant on a given platform. When your will, therefore, become a participant in your pursuit of life, it has to identify a course that uniquely defines you and matches your will and is able to bring desired results. So that when you live, we define you by what you lived for. That's life. What did you live for? What purpose? Listen, friends. Purpose and your will must marry if a baby called success has to be born. Purpose and your will must marry if a baby called success has to be born. Purpose and your will must marry if a baby called success has to be born. Let's address that issue this week on living a strategic life. Listen, you can make a decision with a will that is linked to your purpose, and I guarantee you, success will be your baby. I speak a blessing to you. Good afternoon. May the Lord watch over you. I decree that your Monday is blessed. Your Tuesday is blessed. Your Wednesday is blessed. Your Thursday is blessed. Your Friday is blessed. Your Saturday is blessed. And your Sunday is blessed. May this truth find room in your heart and illuminate your path. I bless you. And I dedicate you to the journey of life. May you find meaning in all you do. In Jesus' name. Amen. Remember, this is our church platform. If you wish to worship the Lord with your offerings, why not? We've been in a service. Our pay bill number will always be projected. If you are part of this house, or you acknowledge this grace, and you want to give your tithe, your offerings, your thanksgiving, that pay bill is our account. Just indicate what you're giving towards, and it will be celebrated and blessed. Good afternoon, blessings. I'll see you again tomorrow, same time, on the same platform, as we establish a strategic Shalom, blessings. We'll see you again. Bye-bye.
Now listen, you don't need to have my size to serve God. Serve God faithfully in what He has entrusted you to. If you are a cleaner, don't feel like you are less. You will be rewarded not for what you do, but by doing it faithfully. God does not reward work. He rewards faithfulness. Now listen, the reason why God does not reward work is because I can force you to work.